Welcome back to Ring of Fire. I'm Mike Papantonio. When it comes to putting regulations in place that save American lives, corporate America has put their best lobbyists to work to stall or prevent those regulations from being put in place. Joining me now to talk about corporate America's drive to deregulate us to death is Farron Cousins from the Trial Lawyer magazine. So Farron, if you're a president or a legislator and you want to make the American public believe that you're actually taking action by passing some bill or passing an executive order, but you don't really want anything to happen, what do you do with it?
You send it to the White House Office of Information and Regulatory Affairs. That is where all good regulations go to die. You get out there on the stump, you come up with all these grand plans that we're going to rein in, you know, these corporate fat cats on Wall Street, we're going to take charge on these environmental polluters, and then you send those regulations to the OIRA, where essentially nothing happens for years and years and years.
It's a great scam because it does allow the politician to tell his voters that, you know, I'm doing something when he knows he's going to make it disappear. What do the numbers look like? Just give us a sense of what are the numbers of bills that move into this OIRA and disappear and nothing ever happens.
Well, right now, the way the system works is that the Congress will come up with a regulation and they'll send it off to the OIRA and they have 90 days to respond or to, you know, enact the regulations. And right now, I believe there's about 120 regulations that have been sitting there over past due, some of them by as much as, you know, 5 or 6 years. That's how long they've been sitting there waiting to be enacted. But both Bush, when he was in office, and Obama have just been sitting on them doing absolutely nothing. And in the meantime, people are dying as a result of these regulations not being put in place.
Give us some examples. Give us a couple of examples of just how serious this is. This isn't just minor regulations. These are regulations that really do go to the heart of whether people live or die, right?
They do. And I think one of the most important ones that's been stalled is this backup monitoring system for vehicles. You know, this was brought about by a 2-year-old boy who was killed when his father in the driveway accidentally backed over him. So the regulations came up that we're going to put backup monitoring systems on all new cars. Well, instead of actually doing anything, the auto industry lobby got their hands on the White House, met with the president countless times with no other audience. There's no record of what happened during those conversations. And to this day, that regulation has not been put in place. And this is in spite of the fact that we know thousands of people die every single year from being backed over by an automobile. And they've done the math and they know that if they enact this particular regulation, if they make auto companies put backup monitoring systems on their vehicles, it will save at a minimum of 100 lives every single year, if not more.
Farron, as editor of the National Trial Lawyer magazine, you are clearinghouse for these stories. You've been doing this for years. You've seen the stories coming in for years where a piece of legislation will be passed and the general public is jubilant. Oh, great. This is going to solve the problem. It's going to stop the pharmaceutical companies from making products that kill us. It's going to stop the automobile industry from making defective products. And the person out there really believes something's going to happen. And the people who pass it use this methodology time and time again. Tell us the story about silica. Isn't that another one of those stories?
Silica is, you know, and you know, countless workers in this country are exposed to silica dust every day, usually in the construction and manufacturing. And this is a substance that gets in the lungs, causes severe diseases. And Congress, the White House, you know, scientists have known about this for decades. And to this day, that regulation is still sitting in that OIRA office waiting to be enacted. And again, it's the same story like with the backup monitoring system. The industry sends out their best lobbyists, sometimes even CEOs. They meet specifically with the president. They meet in the Oval Office sometimes. The doors are closed. There's no public knowledge of what's being said, what's going on. But as we, you know, can clearly see from the evidence, they're telling the president, hey, listen, if you put this regulation in place, it's going to cost us a little bit of money.
So, tell us how this affects. I mean, one great example to me that I think people don't understand is people think that after Wall Street committed the crimes that they committed and crashed our economy, stole $18 trillion from American taxpayers, that after that happened, that Dodd-Frank came along and Dodd-Frank cured all that. Now we don't have any problems. Tell us the truth about Dodd-Frank and OIRA and SEC and all the other regulatory agencies.
Well, in its most basic form, Dodd-Frank really doesn't do anything. Dodd-Frank came out and said, we need to come up with a system to identify fraud, to rein in speculators. It basically told them to come up with the formula on how to do that. And as soon as Dodd-Frank, you know, became an idea, Wall Street sent their lobbyists and their attorneys into Washington.
And so what ends up happening, Farron, if I got this right, the pressure comes from the lobby groups. The lobby groups go to Wall Street, for example, goes to a particular congressman. The congressman then has all kinds of ways to further slow down the process once the bill goes to the OIRA. The congressman can say, we have to have some more hearings on it. You need to go to OIRA and present your position. And it's always a one-sided position. I mean, you don't have consumers that get the opportunity to appear in front of the OIRA, but you certainly have lobby groups that pay big money to congressmen so they can go bend the ear and change the law by way of the OIRA. It's not just the OIRA, but that's kind of the methodology, isn't it?
Correct. I mean, I don't know of any consumers, you know, a group of concerned citizens that have gone and been able to have an audience with a congressman, or certainly not the president. But I think what's important about the OIRA is the fact that in January of 2007, George Bush, you know, he knows he's leaving office soon. He's got to give his corporate masters one last big present. And what he gave them was an executive order that significantly increased the White House's control over the Office of Information and Regulatory Affairs. And so now, before any regulation can go out, a lobbyist and industry group can come in there and say, wait, you need more studies. There's not enough studies
on
this.
Okay, so let's put this.
This could affect the economy. This could affect our ability to be competitive in the marketplace. And Bush specifically put that language in that executive order. So now they're tethered to this. And Obama just seems more than willing to play right along with this executive order that he could easily undo.
Well, and he is the master. I mean, truth be told, Obama is the master of the stump speech. That sounds great, and then no action that flows from that great stump speech. So this is perfect for Obama. This is, I mean, you know, if you think about it, his siding with Wall Street has been almost overwhelming. Time and time again, the lack of prosecutions, the intensity with which he has empowered Wall Street even more. And so when he's out there talking about Dodd-Frank on the stump speech or in the media, he knows what's happened to Dodd-Frank. He knows that it's fallen into the black hole. Isn't that kind of how it works?
That is, you know, and again, most of it is coming from these lobbyists. You know, when you read about lobby money, when you read about, you know, political donations, this is what it's for. You know, this is why politicians get money from these massive corporations. A fantastic example of a regulation that has been stalled because of industry influence is the coal ash. And coal ash is what's left over after they burn coal for electricity. And so an entire industry has emerged to reuse this toxic coal ash in society. And it contains, you know, cadmium, mercury, lead, arsenic, things that are deadly in and of themselves that cause cancer. But now, because there's been no regulations, Obama's had, I think, a dozen meetings with industry insiders. There is now an industry that sells coal ash. They use it to de-ice roads in the winter. They're pouring this toxic substance on our roadways. It's getting tracked into people's homes. They're using it to make bricks and concrete. I mean, this stuff is all over the place. And Bush first and now Obama have refused to act on this. And that one is becoming a very serious issue, especially with the Kingston coal ash spill a few years ago.
But Farron, isn't this one of those stories? Don't you remember when there was this big fanfare and parade about, by God, Obama's doing something about the coal industry? Don't you remember that? It was this great fanfare. This is a president who cares. This is a president who's going to change something. And then all of a sudden, now we're learning that the way that he stopped all of it was just to say, okay, lobbyist, Go tell your story as long as you want, as often as you want, as one-sided as you want, as corrupt as you want, and the bill doesn't go anywhere. Well, look, what about the food industry? I mean, we've seen all these laws coming out about we need safer food. Food imports are killing people. I think 60 to 80% of the imported vegetables and fruits, for example, come from all over the country, all over the world, not just this country. So we needed to gain control over monitoring that. Did we?
Oh, absolutely not. I think at this point, only about 2% of our imported food is actually inspected. And as a result, just a couple years ago, we imported, a bunch of chilies from Mexico. They went out to the Midwest, and people started getting salmonella from these chilies because nobody inspected it.
But we were told, here's the point. We were told that there are new laws on the books that are supposed to be protected. People would die. There'd be a salmonella outbreak. People would die, and the congressman or the president would say, we have this under control. We have new laws that are solving this. Where did it go as it went into that black hole?
Just where all the other ones go, to the OIRA. Is sitting on it, effectively killing it. But that's the thing. These politicians are able to go out there and tell the American public that we have developed new rules that's going to make your food safer, it's going to make your environment cleaner, it's going to make Wall Street more honest, it's going to make your vehicle safer. And they can say that, and they aren't lying. But what they're not telling is the second part of the story, that yeah, we came up with these regulations, but we're letting the industry have their way with these regulations before they're enacted. And even if they do get enacted, it still takes years before they're actually enforced.
So yeah, on this issue alone, just food real quickly, I mean, 48 million Americans get sick from imported foods, 120,000 are hospitalized, 3,000 die. That's been taking place again and again ever since they said they were going to do something, which was really as early as 2010, when they said, well, we've got this under control, we're going to do something. So people continue to die. In about 30 seconds, do you see any way to really turn this around while the lobby money's out there?
With the lobby money, I really don't, unfortunately. But Obama has the power, and he does respond well to public pressure. If the public gets out there and demands that he issues an executive order to get these lobbyists out of the OIRA, then perhaps we could do something, or maybe speed up the process in some way. He responds to pressure, and that's what we have to do.
Yeah, that seems like the only thing he responds to. Thank you, Farron, for joining me.
Thank you.